Hello viewers, in previous lecture we discussed about slave dynasty, the introduction of slave dynasty, and this was the introduction of Delhi dynasty actually. And in Delhi dynasty, very first clan or dynasty was established, that was called slave dynasty or Mamluk dynasty. So in previous lecture we already discussed on all aspects of this slave dynasty or Mamluk dynasty, and we introduced why we call it Mamluk. So today we are going to discuss on the very first ruler or founder of this great dynasty, Delhi dynasty. Now we will discuss the name and his tenure of Delhi dynasty. So the name of this first ruler who was coronized a free ruler of this particular Delhi dynasty, name was Qutbuddin Aibak. This man Qutbuddin Aibak was a Mamluk ruler, king, and already we clarify the word Mamluk. It, this word is Arabian word, and this refers to a person whose parents were free but he was a slave. And as we know that in that particular time period, slave trading was not banned and it was recognized by the rulers and the dynasties. So we can discuss that very first ruler of this Delhi dynasty was Qutbuddin Aibak. So now we will discuss in our further lectures regarding all the rulers of this Mamluk dynasty. And later on we will discuss on all the rulers they ruled in Delhi dynasty, all the clans, all the dynasties like Ghulam or slave, Khilji, Tughlaq, Sayyid and Lodi. So very first dynasty was established, that is called slave dynasty or Mamluk dynasty. Now we will discuss on this very first man who established this free Delhi Sultanate or Mamluk dynasty in this area in Indian subcontinent. So that is Qutbuddin Aibak. Qutbuddin Aibak was very faithful and competent, efficient servant and a military person, a soldier of his master Muhammad Ghori. When Muhammad Ghori came in Indian subcontinent, so this man came with him and he served him with his all his efficiency and faithfulness. So when Muhammad Ghori returned to his place, but unfortunately he was died, accidentally he was died, he was killed by a tribe Khokar. So he could not assign his successor for his huge dynasty in Indian subcontinent as well in Ghazni. Now this particular area was uncontrolled and it was very necessary to declare the rulers or controllers for this whole area or whole continent. Now we will see here, it was divided in three parts because Muhammad Ghori has no successor, but his official successor was Mahmud, and Mahmud never interfered in this dynasty and next successors, those who ruled in his dynasty in Ghazni, because Tajuddin Eldoj, Nasiruddin Qubacha and Qutbuddin Aibak. This dynasty was distributed among these three slaves of Muhammad Ghori. So we can see here that Qutbuddin Aibak was the very first ruler who was controller or ruler, particular free ruler of this particular dynasty that is called Indian or Delhi dynasty. So we will discuss with the topic and this man Qutbuddin Aibak with a brief history or brief story. So as we know, Qutbuddin Aibak, who established his free Delhi dynasty or Mamluk dynasty in this Indian subcontinent, he belonged to a specific tribe of Turkish background. It was called Aibak tribe, and this word Aibak means god of moon, and he born in the area of Turkestan. When he born in Turkestan and in his childhood, he fallen apart from his parents. Because of that, he was sold in a market as a slave. Fortunately, in Nishapur market, Qazi Fakhruddin Abdul Aziz Kuki bought him and take him to his home, and he look after him like his son. He managed his education. He provided him all the education, like language, like religious education, military education, archery. So everything he provided him, he was trained profoundly. Now he was very good and very courageous, very intelligent and very competent man. But unfortunately, this man Fakhruddin Abdul Aziz Kuki died. After his death, sons of this Qazi, they sold Qutbuddin Aibak again. So a trader who bought him, and he again sold him in the market of Ghazni. Here, as we know that because of their efficiency, these slaves were sold on high rates. So he was very efficient and competent slave. So he was sold on very high rate, and Muhammad Ghori bought him on very high rate. And Muhammad Ghori, much influenced and much inspired with his service and his efficiency, so he appointed him his very close and very faithful servant. And he appointed him on the post of Amir-e-Akhur. So this post was very important and very close to the ruler. So this Amir-e-Akhur post was actually, the chief of the horse riding department. And he was a manager of all imperial horses. So this was a time. Now again, the future of Qutbuddin Aibak enlightened, and he was appointed on a very important post, and he served him well. After appointment of this specific post, he performed very faithfully and very efficiently, and he served him in some specific battles behalf of Muhammad Ghori, in the battle of Ghor, in battle of Bamiyan, and the battle of Ghazni. So Muhammad Ghori also much inspired with his efficiency in with his service. So he came more closer to him. Now when Muhammad Ghori came to Indian subcontinent with his army, So he wanted to conquest all this area of this India's subcontinent. He brought this man, Qutbuddin Aibak, with him, with her, as a army leader, army chief. He performed well, and he assisted him in every battle. In first battle of Tarain, he assisted Muhammad Ghori. Second battle of Tarain in 1192, he also served him. And in the battle of Kannauj in 1194, actually, he also served him very well. And he also secured most of Indian subcontinent, where Muhammad Ghori appointed him to conquest. He performed perfectly and successfully. He captured all the area for his master. Not only he assisted him in conquests or in invasions, but after invasions, he also assisted him to suppress revolts in these particular areas. Like a revolt in Ajmer and a revolt of Meerut. He assisted him and he successfully suppressed all these revolts in this particular area. In 1197, he also invades Gujarat. And the capital of Gujarat was Anhilwad. So he ravaged Anhilwad very brutally. And because he wanted to punish king of this Anhilwad, Bhim Dev II. Because when he invades very first on this Anhilwad in Gujarat and in the temple of Somnath, so that time this man ran away from this battleground, and he wanted to suppress him finally. So this was a golden chance for him to suppress him after Muhammad Ghori. In 1202, he also invades Bundelkhand region, where ruler was Parmardi Dev, and he captured Kalinjar and Mahowa dynasty in that particular time. Now we can see here, he was a great servant and a faithful servant of his master Muhammad Ghori. So Muhammad Ghori was much delighted and much pleased with him, and he wanted to appoint him his representative in this particular subcontinent. But unfortunately, we will see here that he was killed untimely. So it was a time of a contradiction. So who will be the successor, next successor of this great dynasty? Because from his clan, Muhammad Ghori never liked any tribal leader of Turkish background, because they were not competent to control his dynasty and to maintain his dynasty very well. So he always said, it is not no matter that I have no successor, because he had no son, he had no successor. So he always said that I know that I have no successor, but I have thousands of my sons. So he wanted to appoint a successor among these slaves. So it was very important thing that in that time, Muhammad Ghori was much pleased with these slaves. These important slaves were three. First was Tajuddin Eldauj, second was Nasiruddin Kuvacha, and third was Qutbuddin Aibak. They three were very close to him, and he was much delighted, much pleased with them. Regarding his quotation, Minhajuddin Siraj, a historian Minhajuddin Siraj quoted this statement of Muhammad Ghori, that no matter I have no son, but I have thousands of sons. So, as we know that after his death, he could not appoint his successor in his time. So, after his death, all these three important slaves, they decided to distribute his dynasty among them. So, very first man, Tajuddin Eldauj, who was appointed in his dynasty Ghazni, and second man Nasiruddin Khwaja, who held the area of Multan and Sindh, and this man Qutbuddin Aibak controlled third area or third part of Indian subcontinent, mid Indian subcontinent, eastern Indian subcontinent. This is called Delhi dynasty or Delhi Sultanate. So after conquest of Muhammad Ghori, we will directly clarify this particular whole area. It was divided in three parts. One is his original dynasty is Ghazni, where Tajuddin Eldauj was ruling, and second part Sindh and Multan region where Nasiruddin Khwaja was ruling, and third region is Delhi dynasty where Qutbuddin Aibak is ruling. So we will discuss on this region where Qutbuddin Aibak was ruling. In this region we can see here Sialkot, Lahore, Ajmer, Jhansi, Delhi, Meerut, Aligarh, Kannauj, Banaras, Bihar and Lucknowi region were included in this area where Qutbuddin Aibak was ruling. So this is a particular area where Qutbuddin Aibak established his free Delhi dynasty. So we will study about this Indian subcontinent region, and with this we will also take a brief look on these dynasties in Ghazni and Multan and Sindh, because Tajuddin Eldauj, who permitted by his official successor Mahmud in Ghazni as a successor in Ghazni for Muhammad Ghori, so he wanted to control all the area like Multan and Sindh in Indian subcontinent, because when he was appointed and he was approved the previous or original Ghazni dynasty ruler, so he wanted to capture all this area, wanted to control, because he declared himself the whole sole successor of Muhammad Ghori here. So always he tried to capture this particular whole dynasty and whole area that Muhammad Ghori earlier conquested or invaded. When Qutbuddin Aibak was approved to rule in this Indian subcontinent, it was not a very easy task to control this area, because he had to face lots of opposition, lots of revolts in this particular region, especially by Rajputs and local dynasties. They were not intent to accept him as their ruler, because this was very first Muslim dynasty who captured this whole area, and these previous kings were not agreed to accept them as their ruler because they wanted to remain the dynasty free. They were actually small dynasties and they wanted to behave spontaneously, freely, so they were not ready to accept any subordinateship of a big dynasty. But this man Qutbuddin Aibak established very first time a huge dynasty in this continent, subcontinent, and wanted to control all these dynasties under his Delhi dynasty. So he tried to control them and he tried to restore his dynasty in this region, because this was a very first problem that to extend his dynasty, it was rather than to extend his dynasty, it was very important to secure the boundaries and to strengthen his existence, his dynasty to become to make it permanent. So it was a very important task for him. So we can see here that he concentrated in this particular first task, that to strengthen his situation, his position, his dynasty, and he wanted to secure his dynasty and the boundaries of his dynasty. So he never tried to expand around this region, but he wanted to secure and he wanted to make it stable. So here he had to first thing to do to stable himself in this Indian subcontinent. Now we will classify the tenure of Qutbuddin Aibak in Indian subcontinent in three parts. First part of his tenure, that was start from 1192 to 1206, where he was just like a representative of Muizuddin or Muhammad Ghori. But in second phase, from 1206 to 1208, he was not only a representative, but he was a leading official in this region behalf of Muhammad Ghori. But in third phase, from 1208 to 10, he was a free ruler of this conquest place. So we will see here, these three tenures can be categorized. In this very first phase, he spent his most of his time in conquests, in invasions, in missions. And second phase, he invested in political activities. And the third phase, he invested to build map of Indian subcontinent, of Delhi Sultanate, Indian subcontinent. So these three phases can be categorized in three particular tenures of his according to his activities. So this is a very clear picture of his tenure. Now we will discuss on his works as a ruler in Indian subcontinent and to establish the Delhi dynasty in this region. Now we will discuss on his coronation. Qutbuddin Aibak coronized on 26th of June 1206 AD. After his coronation, he requested to official successor of Muhammad Ghori, Mahmud, to approve his kingship in this dynasty. And after 2 years, in 1208, this particular man, official successor of Muhammad Ghori, Mahmud, accepted him the ruler of this Indian subcontinent, and he provided him approval with a symbol. He sent him a throne, he sent him some symbol like a flag, a specific flag for him, and also sent a timpano. And these symbols were actually approval of this King Mahmud, and he also accepted him Sultan, and he also given him the title of Sultan. But we know, and this is to be very careful, that Qutbuddin Aibak never used this title of Sultan. He was satisfied with his titles, previous titles, Malik and Sipahsalar, who was given him or provided him by his master Muhammad Ghori, because he was very faithful ruler. And he also satisfied as his representative in Indian subcontinent, and he never tried to release any coins and announce any khutbah for his name. But he was satisfied with the position of his representative. But this was the situation when he wanted to secure him and he wanted to strengthen him, he wanted to make him powerful in this particular in this time period. Now we can see here that he established his capital in Lahore, that is now in Pakistan. Now we will discuss on the hurdles or the problems of Qutbuddin Aibak he faced after his coronation. When he coronized on this throne of Delhi Sultanate, he had to face many challenges. The challenges they presented not only by local rulers but some Turkish rulers also, because all this area of Indian subcontinent was mostly controlled by Turkish invaders, because it was started from northwest region to eastern region like Bengal and in mid region. So in Bengal area there was also a Turkish ruler who was controlling that region, and in northwestern region the two opponents were there, Tajuddin Eldauj and Nasiruddin Qubacha. We already discussed about them. So they both wanted to control this Indian subcontinent also, because they wanted to extend their boundaries in this region, because they realized that their master Muhammad Ghori could not declare their successor, so they deserved to be his successor, so they wanted to grab all the particular area. So that was the reason they presenting problem in front of Qutbuddin Aibak. They wanted to grab, they wanted to capture the dynasty from the hand of Qutbuddin Aibak in Indian subcontinent. Now we will see here there were two important tasks in front of Qutbuddin Aibak. Number one task was to strengthen his administrative system in Indian subcontinent, and second to deal with his opponents and with the challenges they were presenting. So very first thing he concentrated on to strengthen his administration, and second thing to secure his dynasty and make it stable. So these two tasks he performed to govern his dynasty, and he chose these two tasks to deal with them very first. Because he was a competent and diplomatic ruler, so he used his diplomatic policies to control the situation. Very first, he married to daughter of Tajuddin Eldauj, and he married his sister with Nasiruddin Qubacha, and he married his daughter with Iltutmish. So these three were very powerful in that time, and he wanted to secure himself with three areas. Afterwards, he wanted to secure, and he wanted to face all the challenges presented by local dynasties. So very first he had to solve the big problems presented by these two opponents, Nasiruddin Qubacha and Tajuddin Eldauj. So he started to practice a diplomatic policy, and he made them his relatives. Now he released his burden for challenges with this new relations, with these new relations. But we will see here, after marriage he was silent for some time, but Tajuddin Eldauj invades Qutbuddin Aibak to capture his dynasty, but Qutbuddin Aibak started to retaliate against him, and he moved towards Ghazni, and he invades Ghazni and finally captured this area. But the local leaders and citizens of this Ghazni did not accept it, Qutbuddin Aibak as his ruler. So he had to leave this specific area and he moved back to Indian subcontinent. But after this defeat, Tajuddin Eldauj never tried to invade Qutbuddin Aibak, because now he realized that Qutbuddin Aibak is more powerful than him. Second opponent was Nasiruddin Qubacha, who was ruling Multan and Sindh area. And after the death of Muhammad Ghori, he also started to behave spontaneous, and he also wanted to capture Indian subcontinent or Delhi dynasty, because he realized that he is a competent successor of Muhammad Ghori. Now, but this man Qubacha realized that Qutbuddin Aibak is more powerful, so he married his daughter and he accepted his subordinateship very easily, and he kept him in his control. And there was not only these two opponents who were presenting challenge in front of Qutbuddin Aibak, but another challenge was presenting by a ruler of Khwarizm. So this man, ruler of Khwarizm Shah, who was increasing his power towards Indian subcontinent, so it was a very big problem for Indian subcontinent or Delhi dynasty. It can be in the future. So Qutbuddin Aibak also wanted to deal with this specific problem. So he concentrated on this situation. So he wanted to strengthen this man Nasiruddin Qubacha in mid area, because when this man Khwarizm Shah will invade Indian subcontinent, so he has to come through this Sindh and Multan area. So when he will attack on Delhi dynasty, so he can easily control in this particular area, and he can check him in outer boundary of Indian subcontinent. So that was the reason that he succeed to make this Qubacha agree with his policy. Now he wanted to break this particular dynasty, Delhi dynasty, from Mideast dynasty, because if the boundaries were connected to Mideast, always it is unsecured. So that was why he separated his continent or his dynasty from Mideast continent. So he never interfered in the politics of Mideast. So he separated his dynasty and he established a dynasty towards northeast or northwestern side or south northwestern side or southeastern side of Indian subcontinent. Now he concentrated towards southeastern side and northeastern side. Now we will discuss with another problem in Indian subcontinent. It was arising from Bengal region. In Bengal, in the time of Muhammad Ghori, Muhammad Bakhtiar Khalji, who controlled this Bengal region, and he controlled and he declared himself a ruler of this Bengal region. So he was ruling, but another leader, Turkish leader named Ali Mardan Khan, killed him and declared himself a new ruler of Bengal. But this Khalji tribe never accepted this new man named Ali Mardan Khan, so they revolted against him. Now Ali Mardan Khan escaped himself and ran away from Bengal and reached in the court of Qutbuddin Aibak. Now the Khilji tribes, they appointed a new man named Muhammad Shera, a new ruler of Bengal, and on the condition that he will never accept the subordinateship of Qutbuddin Aibak. So he accepted this proposal and he declared himself the new ruler. But this man Ali Mardan Khan reached to get help from Qutbuddin Aibak, and Qutbuddin Aibak helped him. Now Qutbuddin Aibak decided to invades Bengal region, and he ordered to his governor of Awadh, governor of Awadh, name was. Now this was a golden chance in front of Qutbuddin Aibak to control the situation and to capture Bengal region. So he directed his governor, one of governor, name was Kemaz Rumi, who was governor of Awadh region, Awadh province. And now it is situated in near Lucknow region. So it was called Awadh region, and he was governor of Awadh region, and he directed him to invade this man Shira Khan, Muhammad Shiro, and he conquested Bengal and appointed this man Ali Vardhan Khan a new or next ruler of Bengal. Now this man Ali Mardan Khan, his whole life remained faithful and trustworthy, and he accepted subordinateship of Qutbuddin Aibak. So this way Qutbuddin Aibak established and extended his boundaries towards Bengal region. Second local problem was presenting by Rajputs. So Qutbuddin Aibak wanted to control this Rajput revolt, but unfortunately in 1210 in Lahore he was playing polo or chaugan. He fell from his horse and he accidentally died. So he could not fulfill his desires to maintain or to establish a final or free dynasty in Delhi Sultanate, and he could not frame it properly. But after his death, his slave or his successor Iltutmish fulfilled his desire and make it possible what Qutbuddin Aibak wanted to do. Now this man Qutbuddin Aibak ruled only for 4 years as a free ruler of Indian subcontinent, king of Indian subcontinent or the ruler of Delhi dynasty. But we can see here in this short term he extended his boundaries, and he proved himself as a very competent soldier also and a competent ruler.